The Indians were in a great hurry about something and were packing up and getting away as fast as they could. In their opinion, a flood was coming. The weather was perfectly clear, and this was not the rainy season. There was about a foot of water in the insignificant river, maybe 2 feet. So, where was the flood to come from? At 7 in the evening, we went to bed in the second story. An hour later, we were awakened by a great turmoil. A glance revealed a strange spectacle under the moonlight. The crooked Carson was full to the brim, and its waters were raging and foaming in the wildest way, sweeping around the sharp bends at a furious speed, bearing on their surface a chaos of logs, brush, and all sorts of rubbish. We suddenly realized that this flood was not a mere holiday spectacle, but meant damage. At 11 o'clock, only the roof of the little log stable was out of water, and our inn was on an island in mid-ocean. As far as the eye could reach, in the moonlight, there was no desert visible, but only a level waste of shining water. The Indians were true prophets, but how did they get their information? I am not able to answer the question.
So in 1861 and 1862, there was a series of atmospheric rivers that occurred over the course of about a month. And that's one of the biggest storms on record that we have in sort of these contemporary records. Atmospheric river is a long corridor of water vapor transport that's typically tapping in moisture from the tropics. At any given moment, there are 5 or 6 of them kind of rotating across the earth. But when they make landfall, like on the coast of California, for example, that water vapor gets uplifted by the mountains, it cools, and then we get massive amounts of rain. Atmospheric rivers are the major source of winter storms here in California and even in Nevada on the other side of the Sierra Nevada. And so understanding the patterns of these and how they might change with climate change is very important, both in terms of understanding our water supplies as well as flood risks in the region. So Daniel Swain and Xinying Wang developed a model of the Arkstorm scenario, which is a 30-day storm sequence that had massive amounts of precipitation across California and Nevada. With the meteorology from that storm in hand, we are now going to apply that in partnership with the National Weather Service and other partners to look at how that might translate into stream flows and flooding in this region. We send this storm through a model through the California Nevada River Forecast Center, and they translate that into flows on the Truckee River, the Carson River, and the Walker River. From there, we are working with the Truckee River Flood Management Authority to look at how those stream flows would, you know, spread out and inundate and flood the Truckee Meadows region. And this is going to provide sort of the basis for understanding what the economic impacts from an extreme storm like this might be, who is most in danger, and things like that. In addition to that, we're working with the U.S. Geological Survey, and they are running the ArcStorm scenario through their models to look at where landslides and debris flows are most likely to occur, so we can identify which roadways, for example, or structures might be endangered by, you know, this extreme storm event. So our project is aimed towards trying to talk with the community members about what they learned and how they would respond you know, going forward to an extreme winter storm event like Arkstorm that is, you know, probably bigger than one they've experienced, but the probability of something like this happening with climate change is increasing. There needs to be discussion about how to prepare. The general idea is we want this to serve as sort of a demonstration project of how you can use an extreme storm scenario. It could be extreme fire or extreme heat, something like that, and use that as a basis for discussing impacts and opportunities to better adapt to climate change in any small region. And we're also developing a map application, and I see that as something that could be transferable. So this will allow people to sort of look at the inundation, flood inundation overlaid in the Reno area and identify, you know, who is impacted and by how much. And again, we'd like to sort of use that as a framework for other places, because ultimately, you know, we can think about Arkstorm and say, oh, these big numbers about how much water and flooding there will be in California, but ultimately, it's about these small communities. That's where the response is starting, and so we need to be engaging these local communities and working out from there.